my question goes back to the text, which is kind of avoided. The issues you listed are all financial, energy, obviously related. And yet there is no platform for us to discuss this with Europe. Now, there's the G20, but that involves the developing countries, and it's hard to have a dialogue just between the two of us in preparation for that. And you see the differences that occur in Korea and the criticism of the Germans. The problem that I see, having worked in Brussels, is that the tradition of the NATO predominance in the relationship, that NATO is the indispensable linchpin of our relationship with Europe. Everything revolves around NATO. Everything revolves around NATO. All the medals ringing on the ground, all the money, all the big cars, all the big conferences, it's all NATO all the time. NATO can't deal with financial regulation. NATO can't deal with sovereign debt. NATO can't deal with energy. NATO can't deal with climate. NATO can't even deal with counterterrorism, which gets into finances because you're going for information, transportation flows, airline flows, banking flows. NATO can't deal with any of that. And we don't have anything parallel NATO to really talk about the problems that you all do just about.
Let's say, first I should have said it when I started, that of course all this discussion, you know, I'm in a university, the place of free thought, that's a lot of personal thinking rather than official positions, it goes without saying, but I say it now, better late than never. On that point, and I think that's something, again, you express a feeling and the thought that we have shared a lot, and we are very much on the same side on that. I think there is something profound in that, even beyond EU, US. In fact, if we see at the way the world changes, it is not changing because of security or military projection of power and influence, although it always plays some role, but fundamentally China is not increasing because of the power of the Red Army. It's increasing because of the economics. The geopolitical order is in the process of being modified profoundly because of the economics. And somehow we have not absorbed this enough, I would argue, between the EU and the US certainly, and I would dare saying more, even more on the U.S. side, because this focus on NATO is very much a U.S. Genetic code in dealing with Europe. Yeah, and it has its historical explanations, which are respectable, which are understandable. But somehow the world has moved quicker than our perceptions and the ability to absorb what's happening, I'm afraid, despite our sophistication and the quality of the people that are involved in all aspects of the relationship. You know, it illustrates how much the human being is a habit of behavior animal. We deal on what we know. We behave on the basis of what we are used to do. You know, so NATO has been historically the center of everything. But in the relations with the with Europe, like in the global picture, we should concentrate much more on what is economic, what are really the forces that are creating the geopolitical shift that is taking place, and from that point of view, we should become much more able than we have historically been to coordinate more. And I would subscribe to what you started saying about the Transatlantic Economic Council, the effort to create a forum where we coordinate sufficiently with the United States. I mean, we do not coordinate sufficiently with the United States on what is changing the geopolitical map of the world. It's not something that we can be proud about, you know, because we are part of this effort. I think we shared this feeling for several years, and we worked in that direction. But I think it's a huge reality of our times. So I hope we will see something profoundly different in the coming years, that the effort that we started with tech will cover more successfully the regulatory aspect, which is fundamental for the economic interaction, and it will become also the forum of a real coordination between the two more important players, again, on what is changing the geopolitics of our times, a complex history, but within which we are completely on the same side, objectively. Operationally, we still need to absorb it further.
Well, I'm Richard Williams of the Mercatus Center at George Mason University. I wanted to just address one of the things, and it seems as though you were looking for coordinated responses to global challenges for everything. And I'm reminded of the 1970s, which was sort of the banner year for a lot of pronouncements about great crises that the world was facing. And one in particular strikes me, and that was the Club of Rome, which was a very serious, made some very serious pronouncements about how within a few decades the world would be completely out of oil, it would be completely out of natural gas, would be out of zinc and copper and other sorts of materials. They were wrong. They were completely wrong, and there were so many of these other pronouncements that were wrong. And I worry that there's a situation where, as these pronouncements occur, you can get a global bandwagon effect, where all of a sudden, then we need a coordinated global response. A global response to that pronouncement, or many others, would have been a worldwide disaster into what we do. So what operates as a check to make sure that what the world is addressing is, in fact, a real problem?
I respect that. There are several ways to be wrong. Certainly, we can exaggerate one way or the other, no doubt. The question is exactly that. The question is about striking the right balance, recognizing the challenges of our times correctly. If you don't recognize the challenge correctly, then the response can be wrong in one direction or the other. So I would say that this kind of approach from that point of view, it has to be a kind of constant argument that we need to keep in mind, the test really, make sure that we are not overdoing in the other direction. I'm not saying that we need a kind of world government, you know. The EU itself, despite the perception that many have in this country about the EU, is not about putting everything together. It's putting together what we need to put together. I'm a convinced European. I have invested all my life promoting a deeper European integration. But which integration? Huh? I'm more Greek now than when I started, I tell you. I have always been very proud of what I am. I don't intend to be less of what I am because I'm a European. But I don't need to be less Greek to be a good European. In fact, I feel more and more, you know, that more better Greek I become, better European I become. There is no contradiction. We are looking for Europe in a system of governance that respects the differences and puts together the member states and our ability to act together where we need to act together, and where by acting together we become more efficient for the interest of our citizens. That's the basic concept of it. That people, unfortunately, do not understand enough. Europe is not another state. And that's why it is a kind of useful reference at the global stage. The effort, and of course it's a challenge, and we can overshoot. Too much of it can be a bad thing, because it reduces freedom and liberty. It alienates identity. It's not what we want. We want people who, in the complexity of modern societies, have more and more free space of choice, because it comes back to the quality of democracy, all the system, right? So if you put too much of getting together, it can work the opposite direction. We have to be careful about that. This being said, I do believe that we really live in the transformative threshold of human history, at least compared with our current level of technological civilization. There are things, it's not, there's no doubt at all that That's why I mentioned these three basic concepts, that globalization is accelerating because of technological progress. There is no doubt at all that global governance in all its aspects, more or less important, it's really tested by the geopolitical change that is taking place in favor of the emerging countries. And there is no doubt at all that we are reaching some limits of Mother Nature. The rare earths, the recent crisis of the rare earths in China, the competition that we see to access resources of Africa, and all the big questions that it raises. What is happening in Latin America in terms of competition to access resources. The energy debate and energy security of Europe and others. These are things that are not in the normal course of history that have always been with us. And this deeper interdependence, you know, we felt it so much among Europeans. Look what happened with the Greek crisis, to take an example. You cannot have a common currency if one sovereign entity becomes irresponsible. So you cannot say that what they do is just their business. It's enormously my business, or the others' business too. What Irish will do now, or have done up to now, affects directly the interest of all Europeans, and maybe the whole world. The whole world trembled in the case of, when we came close to the debt crisis of Greece, I got 2% of the European GDP. So I take your point, but it's also very important to be very vigilant not to miss the other way around, and I keep my fundamental approach that I think we live in a period which is unique. We live in a transformative period of the world history, almost of the history of human being on this earth, you see. I think we enter into a new phase in the history of civilization. Many respects. But we should keep somebody with your argument always next to my own. I fully accept that.
Take one more question and then we'll break open the cookies.
Great. I'm Margaret Polsky. I'm a political economist. I affiliate with George Mason University and the Mercatus Center. And I also consult with the U.S. government on a lot of different kinds of policy issues. I deeply appreciate all of your remarks and the challenges that ambassadors raised as well. We have a couple of issues that pop up for me are, one, what are those critical issues about which we can agree that we must coordinate about? And then what are the coordination challenges? What mechanisms, what platforms do we need to actually effectively coordinate? So as a kind of concrete example, something that's very top of mind right now is the U.S. decision to engage in quantitative easing. And that that's not a very popular decision anywhere right now.
Yeah.
And so maybe you could take that and work that a little.
You say, that's why I, when you say what are the main themes or the critical issues, that's why I took three. I like these three categories that I mentioned, you know, accelerating globalization, the emergence of the new players, and then whatever is the limits of Mother Nature. Because I think it's a very convenient intellectually reference to define the key issues of what is happening. So you can put next to these three headings easily the key challenges. I mean, the globalization is mainly, as we said before, is the economy that guides the geopolitical changes that are taking place. This concerns money, monetary issues, stimulus or exit of the strategy, or imbalances. The whole economic thing is the key package under the first heading. Emerging of new countries is everything that concerns the flows of trade, investment, and global governance, the new balance that another group of fundamental issues. And then the limits of Mother Nature, I know it's a little bit, but it's, I like the title. It says what it says. The limits of Mother Nature, I mean, are identifiable, and we see them every day, and it's relatively easy. You can believe more or less in the climate change, but you can, everybody can argue many of the aspects there, but fundamentally we know what they are. And to make the link between the three questions and the issue of governance, you know, I was looking at the results of the G20. G20 talked about many things, but they talked, for example, about the imbalances. Then America wanted a kind of limit to imbalances, which is, again, intellectually very interesting, that the country of free markets and would want to somehow put a kind of administrative limit. I know people who have a tradition in thinking in terms of economic liberty, saying 4% of something of imbalances, my God, and then what? We should have a stick and... Anyhow, America went with a target of putting a limit. The result was a working group of the G20 and the IMF to create indicators and to find ways to start a process of early consultation and see how we can... Then there was the other initiative of the G20 from Pittsburgh for growth. Look at the result. Again, there is an orientation of coordinating economic policies with three key words on how the growth would be, which are very similar to our own three words, how the Europe 2020 growth would be. And in fact, you will see that the outcome that was shaped in the G20 is, I would say, a very close copy, if not a complete copy, of what we have done among Europeans. And I would argue that this is not because our people are so good that they are very convincing. They are very good and they are very convincing. But it's deeper than that, is that we are facing at the global level the same kind of challenges that we are facing among Europeans. And you are dealing with sovereign entities. Sovereign entities, if you respect sovereignty and you still want to manage interdependence, you have to have, you have to find processes that respect this sovereignty. And they still, produce the result that we need in terms of coherence to face the common challenges. So I would argue, speculating about the future, I did it a little bit today, normally it's a kind of golden rule in our job, don't speculate about the future. But in terms of ideas, it's acceptable. I would argue that we will see at the global level more and more of things looking like the European semester that we are initiating in 2011 for the first time, which is this process, 6 months process of coordinating economic policies among Europeans. And what we have seen at G20, it's the beginning of a process that seems to go in that direction.